With the growth of interregional trade, we see luxury goods, more of the luxury goods that were being traded prior to the post-classical period, but also new luxury goods, or at least new luxury goods to certain regions. These were all encouraged by new transportation technologies, new commercial technologies, and also something that's significant is the caravan organization, as well as new forms of credit. Here we see silk and some a painting of the Sina culture in China. You also see cotton, linens, and textiles. The spices, looks like a pile of turmeric. There's probably some peppers in there. And also gems. Precious gems were something that was really important in the post-classical trade routes. As far as silk goes, by the Shang Dynasty, which was 1550 BCE, the sericulture, the raising of these silkworms and production of the silk, developed to a very high degree. These silkworms were domesticated. They were bred for their characteristics, the desirable characteristics. In a typical Chinese farmstead included not only fields for grain and vegetables, but also a grove of mulberry trees and leaves, of which were the sole food of the silkworm caterpillar. Ordinary peasant women were expert in the special techniques associated with silk weaving. Silk weaving was produced in quantity and worn, at least on some occasions, by a wide range of people, not just the aristocracy. And this goes back to the kind of social structure or hierarchy that we saw, in China, and how it differed from the Western civilizations. You didn't have peasants on the very bottom necessarily. They're actually closer to the upper middle in terms of the social hierarchy because of what they produced with the land, from the land, and for the empire and the dynasty. This is the caravanserai on the right. One of the famous examples of these roadside inns would be in Samarkand. The caravan itself can't be taken for granted. This was an organization that lended to much protection for travelers and merchants from bandits along these routes. Also, the camel saddle. The camel saddle is a big deal because it's what's allowing people to harness the work that these animals can do. In terms of navigation, we didn't always have the compass. China had it for a while. It moves along the trade routes, but along the sea routes eventually. For a while, all we had was the astrolabe, which was from the Hellenistic world, this mixing of cultures that we saw from the conquests of Alexander the Great, the Egyptian, Greek, Persian, and influence on Indian culture. Since the astrolabe relies on the stars, right? What do you do when it's a cloudy day? Do you not make it home? The compass is a game changer in terms of the distance and the kinds of sea lanes that these ships are willing to take, since they know that they can orient themselves in terms of relative to where they were over longer distances. They're more likely to take over a longer range, a more far-flung network of sea lanes. This is especially apparent in the Indian Ocean, and then it's going to be more important when we look at crossing the Atlantic Ocean in the early modern period, starting about 1450. This also means larger ship designs make sense. It makes sense to make larger ships, can carry more and go longer distances. So new economic tools, financial devices were developed. The sock system, which is actually a bill of exchange, comes from the Muslim traders. You know, they're known to have used these checks in this sock system since the time of around the 9th century, which was during the Abbasid Caliphate. You know, transporting a paper sock was more secure than transporting money. In the 9th century, a merchant in country A could cash a sock drawn on his bank in country B. You know, also, you know, in the 13th century, the 1200s, this is your time of Marco Polo, in Venice, the bill of exchange was developed as a legal device to allow international trade without the need to carry large amounts of gold and silver. You know, their use subsequently spread to other European countries. Think about it. If you're carrying lots of gold and silver, it's dangerous in terms of being susceptible to thieves, to bandits. But also it's heavy, you know. It's who wants to carry all that? So, you know, the use of paper currency becomes more widespread. It becomes more widespread when governments institute this. This has to be a state-sponsored commercial practice. The paper currency was actually from Chinese block printing originally, kind of a byproduct of Chinese block printing. It starts in the Tang Dynasty, but it wasn't until the Song Dynasty that it becomes institutionalized as a government policy. It had two main advantages over money made out of silver, gold, copper, and iron. As I said before, it was easier to carry around, and the copper and iron could be used in everyday objects. You know, you could save that precious resource for other things. Names and seals were printed and written on paper money by the government officials who issued it. Unfortunately, no written records exist today that allow us to, you know how this system of paper currency actually functioned prior to the Yuan period. The Yuan period is, you know, this is the Mongol dynasty of China that took over the Song and eventually falls, giving way to the Ming. When Marco Polo traveled to China in the 13th century, he was so impressed by paper money that he described how it was made, you know, used, and valued. Paper money was not used in Europe until the 17th century. The trading organizations are rather significant. They develop out of a few needs, in particular the Hanseatic League in Northern Europe is of note. It's also called the Hansa, or the German Hans. I'm probably pronouncing that wrong, but this organization was founded in North German towns and German merchant communities abroad to protect their mutual trading interests. The League dominated commercial activity in Northern Europe from the 13th to 15th century. It's a medieval German word for guild. Hans means guild or association, derived from, you know, a Gothic word for a troop or a company. So the purpose was for mutual security. It was a trade organization. And it was a financial partnership, most notable between the Lübeck herring fishery and the Hamburg salt mines. So makes you, you know, think, like, we don't have refrigerators back then, so for a herring fishery to be viable, you need that salt. Lastly, you know, other state-sponsored commercial infrastructure was put in place in China. The Grand Canal was dug, connecting the rivers in the north and the rivers in the south in major trade cities. This was significant. It was actually, I think it was started by the Sui Dynasty and finished by the Tang Dynasty. It's still used today. It's a vital artery for trade, and you know, once again, it was it was produced by the people of China under the command of the dynasty. So this is, you know, these dynasties and government structures, not unlike the things, the projects that we take on today, making sure that people can move goods from place to place, that trade thrives, which is taxable, you know, which means more tribute and more wealth for the whole dynasty, for the wealthy people, the aristocracy, but in the emperors, but also to be able to take care of the people and to provide more schools, institutions, provide more access for markets and interregional traders. So this is these are significant things that governments did during this time to promote trade.